verses 1 through 9. And we will look at Judges next week. So we are back to Bible Panorama Series, one book for each week. Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. Verse 1. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aid, Moses, my servant is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the great river to Euphrates, all the Hittite country to the great sea on the west. No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their forefathers to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law I, my servant Moses, gave you. Do not turn from me to the right or to the left, but you may be, that you may be successful wherever you go. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, we thank you for giving us your word. Please let this word be your word. It controls our hearts and minds. Protect us from all evil spirits so that we can hear your word, understand your will, and to make our minds to follow. We thank you for giving us the word. Amen. As we resume the Bible Panorama series, let me briefly explain what we have learned in the Moses' five books. I know this is, you know very well this kind of fact, but let me repeat briefly what we have learned. The Bible, the whole Bible begins with the most important statement about creation. In the beginning, God created the heavens and then earth. After creating all things, God created Adam and Eve. So it tells us that the human beings are the center of God's plan. God created all things for human beings' sake. He didn't create human beings to complement his creation. We are the center of his plan. Then God brought Adam and Eve the Garden of Eden. He wanted to build his kingdom for his people where they could have a perfect relationship with him. There was no sickness, no pain, no suffering, no death in the Garden of Eden. Then what happened? As you may know, Adam and Eve sinned against God. Their relationship with God was broken, and they were kicked. Consequently, sin brought suffering, pain, and death to the world. Why do we have pain? Why do we suffer? It is because of the sin. We are destined to die. However, God never gave up building his kingdom for his people. He called Abraham and commanded him, leave your country, your people, your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing for many. It was God's covenant to build his kingdom again. And as we can see, his covenant always comes with three things: land, name, and blessing. So whenever you see God's plan, you may check, what's the land? What's the blessing? What's the name in his covenant? God chose Abraham and blessed him to build the nation of Israel according to his sovereign plan. And we will see the New Testament, the Israel becomes the old nations. It was God's plan to bless all nations through Israel. And later, God changed the name of Abraham to Abraham, which means the father of many, father of many people from all nations. As God commanded, Abraham went to Canaan, the promised land. But Abraham could not possess the land yet because his people were not strong enough. They were not a nation yet, they were just one of many tribes. So they could not, they lived in Canaan, in the promised land, as strangers. Then in his sovereignty, God sent Joseph, Abraham's great-grandson, to Egypt. And that was how Genesis ended. In Egypt, the Israelites were fruitful and increased greatly, multiplied greatly, and they became exceedingly numerous. Because of their increasing numbers, the Egyptians began to persecute Israel. They cried out to God, and God heard their cry. So God sent Moses to deliver Israel from slavery. But the real reason was because Egypt was not the promised land which God designed. So as the Israelites came out of Egypt, God commanded two things to do: to build the tabernacle and to obey the Ten Commandments. So when we read the whole Bible, Old and New Testament, we have to remember, we have to notice, what's the tabernacle? Where is the Ten Commandments? Because that's the two biggest thing for Israel and for those who are chosen by God. That's what we see in Exodus. In the book of Leviticus, God gave Israel extra instructions regarding the Ten Commandments and also the tabernacle, which were given for their purity and holiness. If they wanted to be blessed by God as the chosen people, the Israelites must obey God's commandment. It was given for them for their holiness and purity. The law was given through Moses, so we call Moses' law. That law was not abolished, was not disappeared in the New Testament, but was fulfilled by Jesus. And the tabernacle, where did it go? Tabernacle became Christ's church. So we, as a chosen people in the New Testament, in the age of the church, we must obey God's commandment. What God commanded at the time, we also need to obey. Consecrate yourself. Purify yourself. Be holy, because the Lord said, I am holy. In our obedience, we are worshiping God in Christ's church, in the tabernacle, in the Old Testament, but in Christ's church, in the New Testament. That's the book of Leviticus. Then in Exodus, in Deuteronomy, in Exodus, we see that people who came out of Egypt grumbled, rebelled against Moses and God. They refused to go into the land, into the promised land. And because of their rebellion, they had to wander in the wilderness how long? For 40 years. They couldn't go into the land. And during that journey, two things were changing. The people was changing. People were changing. From Egypt people to Manna people. Those who came out of Egypt all night, but people who grew up in Manna were there. The another change was about leadership from Moses to Joshua. Deuteronomy ends with Moses' death. After Moses' five books, now we come to the history of the Old Testament. We saw already in the major and the minor prophet that God revealed himself through prophecies, through the prophet. Especially we saw the prophecy about Jesus, the coming Messiah. Now in history, we can expect to meet our God throughout the historical event. Not much prophecy, but through historical event. We will see how God would lead and protect his chosen people. The first book of history is Joshua. It consists of three parts. The first part is from chapter 1 through chapter 12, which describes Joshua, Israel's conquest of the land. The second part is from chapters 12 through 21, which is about the distribution of the land. Joshua distributed the land to each tribe. Because when we read that part, we will realize what the land meant for them. See, land is another thing. Then the third part, last part in chapters 23 and 24 is about Joshua's farewell address and his death. That's how Joshua ends. After wandering for 40 years in the wilderness, now the Israelites were camping at Shittim, facing the Jordan River. They were about to go into Canaan. They were anticipating to have many battles along the way to Canaan. I'm sure they were anxious, not only because of the Jordan River or future fight, but also because of Moses' absence. We see the Moses' death in Deuteronomy. The people wondered, they might have wondered, if Joshua was able to lead more than 2 million people into Canaan, was he qualified? People might doubt it about his qualification. And probably, Joshua himself was even more anxious because Moses was not there with him. He always followed Moses. He watched what Moses did. He was Moses' aide. But suddenly, Moses was not there. Could they go into Canaan? Were they ready? They were anxious. Then God's word came to Joshua. No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you, Joshua, forever. I will never leave you nor forsake you. I don't know if there can be any better encouragement than this. The Almighty God promised that he will be with Joshua and Israel forever. And he would never forsake them. He would never leave them alone. That was the greatest encouragement for Joshua and the Israelite. When we move to a new place, we may be anxious because of uncertainty. When our kids go to college, when we relocate for a job, we don't know what's coming, so we may be anxious. But as Paul says, if God is with you, who can be against us? No one and nothing can separate us from the love of God. And we hear the gospel word here too. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their forefathers to give them. It was encouragement. It was affirmation for Joshua when they were anxious going into Canaan. About 20-some years ago, when I came to the USA, I didn't know anyone. I couldn't speak English. I had no money. But I had peace because of this verse. This verse was given to me before I left Korea. God gave me strength and courage. So I came to USA. When I arrived at Denver International Airport, I was welcomed by two different parties whom I never met. I told you I didn't know anyone, but two parties came to and welcomed me. So I had to choose whom I follow. See? God is not just with us, but He goes a place before us. He prepares people who could help. He set the circumstances for our sake. God is not just being with us, but He prepares places, He prepares people, He prepares circumstances for our sake. I'm sure we have many witnesses here who have experienced God's leading. Don't you remember when you left your country? When you went out of the state, or even when you traveled, you experienced God's leading. God was not only with you, but He prepared before you. He went before you and prepared places, people, and circumstances for you. God is leading us. This is the same for our salvation. How can we go to heaven? Have we prayed enough to go heaven? Have we done good things enough to have a ticket to heaven? No. The Bible says there is no one righteous, not even single one in this world. We can't go heaven by our own strength. But we have Jesus paid for that ticket. Jesus promises, I will go there, the Father's house, and prepare a place for you. He goes there before us, prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me. Then you also may be where I am. It's such a blessing. He will never lose you. He will never leave you alone. He will never forsake you. It is God's promise that He will prepare a place before us and take us to heaven when our time comes. What a grace it is. But we must remember that there is no free ticket. Yes, we go to heaven by the grace of God, but that grace is not free. Jesus paid for that ticket. It is given to us, it is given to us, freely given to us. But it was paid by the most precious blood of Jesus Christ. We cannot even buy that ticket. There's too valuable. We have no money, nothing to buy that ticket to heaven, since with our sinful nature. But Jesus paid for that ticket and gave it to us in His grace freely, so we go to heaven. Grace is not cheap. It is the most expensive one that Jesus paid to give us. God is leading us to the promised land, our ultimate home. So that's why we come and thank you. Thank you, Lord, for giving us that ticket. Not only to do anything, but by believing in you, by the faith in you, we can go to heaven. Thank you, Jesus. We praise and we worship. As the Lord led Joshua and Israel, were able to come into Canaan. When they arrived in Canaan, it was a long journey. They defeated 31 kings along the way to Canaan. When they arrived, they thought, oh, we should have no more war, no more war, no more battle. But they realized they had to fight again. In fact, they had to fight even more in the promised land. Why? It is because God hates. They had to destroy evil idols, because if they do not destroy evil, they will be destroyed by evil. They had to fight to become holy and pure God's chosen people in the promised land. Likewise, when we are saved, we need to fight. Our real battle. Before, we didn't care about sin because we were in darkness, but now we are in the light. Sin cannot, should not exist in the light. Before, we belonged to Satan, but now we are children of God. We need to fight as a chosen people, fight against Satan and the evil spirit to keep ourselves holy and pure. The promised land. This battle is not easy. This battle may look foolish to non-believers. They will never understand why we want to go to church every Sunday morning. They will never understand why we stop having parties for our pleasures. They may say, come on, relax, this is your life, you can enjoy your life. This is only one time you have life. But we know we are fighting. We are fighting against the evil spirit to keep our body and soul pure and holy in this promised land. This battle maybe can be difficult. It can be very lonely, tired, and disappointed. So we hear again God's word. Haven't I commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. With that encouragement, we keep fighting. In Jesus' name, who gives us the strength, we can overcome all kinds of. We have a victory in Jesus Christ, who defeated sin and death on the cross forever. The last point of the message is, you can be used by God. Moses grew up in Egypt palace. He was educated in Egypt, one of the most powerful countries at that time. Then he was trained to be a leader in the wilderness for 40 years. He was educated 40 years in the palace. He was trained to be a leader in the wilderness for 40 years. He was ready. He was more than ready. He had the charisma. He knew the strategy. There was no one more qualified than Moses, but God still used Joshua. This one, this tells us that God has a plan for everyone. Moses was used to take out Israelites from Egypt. Then Joshua's mission was to conquer the land. They had a different task. We don't know why, but it was God's plan. Joshua didn't plan to be a leader. He didn't compete with Caleb. He didn't push Moses away, but he just was obedient and faithful to Moses and the Lord. In his time, in his sovereignty, God used Joshua to conquer the land. We don't need to judge ourselves based on our knowledge and experience. When God calls us to a new ministry, we should not worry about whether we can do it or not, because God knows us more than we do. And it is God's ministry. It's not about us. The success of a ministry is the result of God's working, not of ours. We may work hard, but success of a ministry is working through us. That's the ministry. So we should not worry about whether it will be successful or not, because God knows us and He will use us. And if He sees it is needed, then it will be successful, using us, being faithful servants. So we just need to be obedient and faithful to His calling. Either young or old, rich or poor, educated or not, it doesn't matter. God can use everyone for His glory, and it is a blessing to be used by God. We obedient, faithful to His calling. Brothers and sisters, let me conclude. We are living in the promised land. We are already in the promised land. We are living in God's When Jesus comes, He said, He proclaimed, "The kingdom has come. Repent, the kingdom comes," as Jesus is the King of Kings. The fullness of kingdom will come later with Jesus' return, but this is still the kingdom of God. As a kingdom people, we are to experience victories in our everyday, in our life. But we still need to fight. We still need to fight against Satan and evil spirit. Satan's temptations are real. Our enemies are real. They are real and fierce. Temptations may come in every way, in every direction. It may come sometimes through our health, wealth, or finance, or relationships. It comes to us in every direction, and if we are not strong enough, we will be defeated by Satan's temptations. We are chosen. We are God's chosen, God's kingdom people. We should be strong enough. How can we? The God says, be strong and courageous. I am with you. I was with you, and I will be with you forever. Don't you hear that? Don't you see that God is with us? Even though we may feel we are surrounded by many enemies, we may feel lonely, depressed, discouraged. We may feel someday, I want to give up. because the finance, health, sickness, the relationship, it's just too hard, too much. I want to give up, but please remember that God is not only God is with us, but He's fighting. He's fighting for us. That's what the Bible says. For the Lord your God is the one who goes with you to fight against your enemies to give you victory. Brothers and sisters, I don't know what you are facing now. I don't know what you are fighting against now. But I know, as I am too, we are all struggling. We are having difficult times. We may have difficult times. But let us remember, God is fighting for us. So we read once again what the Bible says. Let me read verses 7 and 8. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you'll be prosperous and successful. Truth is, God is with us. God is fighting for us. In the meantime, there is a responsibility for us. We need to obey His command. We need to meditate on the word day and night. The victory is yours. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for giving us the word. It is such an encouragement from you, Almighty God. Be strong and courageous. Father, we have been struggling. We have been discouraged, disappointed. But as your word says, be strong and courageous because the Lord our God is fighting for us. We will be strong again. We cannot do by ourselves, but by the help of the Holy Spirit, in Jesus Christ, who gives us strength, we will fight against the Satan and all kinds of temptations. We are your chosen people. We are kingdom people. Let us experience a victory in our and that we will continue to be obedient and continue to meditate on your word day and night. We thank you, Lord, for your blessings. In Jesus' name.